Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's Boys from the Baltic Star. We're here, the second most famous triumvirate of hosts this day. And what a joy it is to have you with us. You'll be pleased to hear that we all turned down the BBC and we will not be hosting Match of the Day tomorrow in solidarity with Gary Lineker and the rest of them. So you can't stay true.
That's the only reason. The only reason is because of our solidarity.
That's it. They begged, but you know, we remained resolute. Also, there's a yarn. Sorry, I'm fumbling because Ben's made me put this picture up. Anyway, thank you for joining us. If you don't know what that means, don't worry. You get used to it eventually. We are the boys from the Baltic Star, and it's a treat to have you here. And I'm a bit funny. There we go. Let's try that. It's a treat to have you with us tonight. Thanks so much. And Griffin's here chatting already, which we appreciate. We appreciate you, Griffin. We appreciate you. And anyone else that's watching, we appreciate you. Please feel free to chat if you want. Chat is friendly. We will join in with chat when we're not super busy and deep in the roleplay juju. Sometimes even when we are. You can chat about the game, you can chat about yourself, chat about anything you want to. You know, just follow the usual rules of kindliness. Or you can lurk. We love our lurkers. Lurkers are good things. Because if you're listening and giving us a view account, that's good. Happy times for all of us. We get our one cent of advertising every month that way. We appreciate that. It's why we do it, that 1 cent of advertising. We turn all the adverts off if we can. I think we've done the best we can. But yes, if you want to hang around, we'll run 2 and a bit hours maybe. We'll see how it goes. We'll see where the mood takes us. There'll be a break somewhere in the middle when Ben decides we've earned it. Or we've suffered enough, one of the two. And at that point, that's a chance for all of you to go and refill your glasses and empty what you need to empty and come back for the toast in the second half, which is the most important part of the session. In the red sun, you can click the red sun to spend some points. And now some of these are related to this evening, because this evening we are playing Traveller, which is our ongoing science fiction game, something that we've been playing for a couple of years now. But we like to think it's easy enough to jump in on, sort of catch up kind of what's going on within our seasons. There's smaller stories happening in amongst the longer, you know, the longer stream. So we like to think you can jump in on small stories that are going on. So click on that red sun and spend some points. You can, Ben spent Yana, she's the newsreader from news agency, you know, who he loves. He doesn't get it for free anymore. He has to pay his points for her. Ewan's a fan of Muffin. There we are, Team Muffin. So they're rival news agents, reporters, and I'd say love for them on the channel is split very evenly, I would say. There's other things you can spend your points on, so have a flick through, see what you think. Anything with that sort of pinky red will play a sound which might be fun or annoying. The big things that affect the game, Boonsby Wilds of Thousands, regale us with a tale. You can pick a character and they just have to stop at a point they can and just sort of tell a little bit of story about themselves. You can learn out a bit more about them. I can't see what that one says because my box is a bit broken. You can name an NPC. You can spend some points and your character will be in the game forever when Ben decides they best fit in. And it truly has affected the game. Stefan's Sneaky Masterclass is fun, especially for 200. It's so cheap compared to some channels, you know. You can make Stefan steal something, and that has led to many storyline situations. Clonk, you can make someone hit something or someone. Someone made me do it when the police was in the room with me. That made me nervous. there's a whole load of things. Have a flick through, have a read. There's one thing we keep specially. Well, there's two, I guess. There's to Greyhill. Greyhill is a fine barman. You'll learn more about him during the break. And we can raise a glass to him. Oh. That means Ben has to drink. I know most channels are about drinking water, but I doubt Ben is, to be honest. And it's not his night off either. So, exactly. It helps us. So to Greyhill is good to celebrate our old barman. Or if you don't have many credits, but you want to join in with a celebration of something, we keep one credit. I'll drink to that. Anyone can do it at any time. Anyone can just spend a single credit and agree to something or toast to something. That's what we like to do. So there's lots there. Have a look through, see what you like, see what you don't like, spend it or don't. It's all up to you. I think that's all the main intro. It's been very long today. I do apologise. I suppose I better do our introductions to us and then hand over to our referee. My name is Luke. Hello, I'm in the bottom right-hand corner. And I'm in the small space because it's where I belong. And I play two characters. One's just flicked up then. One is Soraya Kansari. She's a scout who spent more than 10 years of her life on the fringes of space, learning how to look after herself and watch sport, but not really learning how to deal with polite company. The other person is Kara, Kara Lasker. She's an artist, a carouser, a trader, a hacker, a musician, a philosopher, all those sort of roles. But she can even punch someone quite hard. But if she takes a shot, she could well die very quickly. So we need to protect her. That's her biggest weakness. Jumping two above me, not this one in the middle, we'll come to him later. Right to the top, literally, figuratively, and morally. It is my brother from another mother. It is the housewife's favourite. It is the beautiful man himself. It is the lovely, charming Ewan. Good evening, Ewan. How are you?
Hey, Luke. I'm good, thanks. I'm very pleased that you said I was morally at the top. It was a close knit call, especially with that all the free brunch that the BBC were offering us. But you know, some things are more important. More important than brunch.
They are good. I'm glad you said that. You were the one I was worried about when brunch was mentioned. Now I say you're morally at the top, but if we were talking about characters, I think that might change somewhat. Might you think?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Recently, I think it certainly has. I play Stefan Miller, who is possibly the most morally grey of all of our characters. He spent some time in some CD groups, not really jetting around the universe, but he is very much a space rogue, and voted most likely to stab someone in the neck in a nightclub. For some reason, I don't know why. And I also play Agnar Arnson, former general of the 17th Riftruns, who is less grey, more morally upstanding. Certainly, probably not the highest, but you know, he's somewhere in the middle. centrist, morally speaking, I would say. But medic, some biology, bit of military tactics. And floofy Barker.
He's a good floofy boy. He's a good boy. Good floofy boy. Speaking of a good floofy boy, is our referee. He is the smartest man in any room. He lives his entire life in the Twin Peaks dream sequence, except for the evenings when he's not role-playing or GMing, where he sneaks into women's bedrooms and leaves chocolatey deposits on their bedside tables.
And all because the lady loves milk tray.
Quick, someone play the soundbite.
I'm on it, you're all right. Otherwise it means nothing at all. He is the magnificent, wise, and very kind to his players, Ben. Good evening, Ben, how are you?
Good evening, I'm well, and very much looking forward to this.
Good. How are you feeling morally with our return to Giikur, by the way? How are you holding up?
I'm pleased to report that my players still have the capacity to surprise me from time to time, and then sometimes to completely not surprise me at all. it's lovely when both of those things happen.
Well, we try our hardest. I'm glad we can still bring you a bit of joy on these dark Friday evenings. So I was just finding my dice. I forgot to take my dice out, which is a terrible mistake. Anyway, should we move over to Ben? Because I think it's time for him to remind us what went on last time and prepare us for this evening's adventures.
Okay. Well, the travellers are getting stuck into the Pelago race on Giikur. Quite stuck in. According to the authorities, they attempted to murder the specialist oceanographer for the VCI team, then moments later tried a mass poisoning of the Maglo team. Stefan and Soraya have fled the scene and taken refuge in a cheap hotel, which is entirely automated. The rest of the gang have been interrogated by the police, notably investigator Brina Locke, which went very well for Kara and went for Agnar. Zoe is still somewhere unknown in the city, while Kat has taken some of the team down to sea level. There they need to use breathing masks to make sure the overly dense air breathable without ill effect. And Agnar, Kara, Freya, Sammy, and Kat have arrived in the cove where the teams all have their headquarters. They passed the subdued Maglo team pavilion and wandered on to where they can approach the target of their mission, the ISB team. As they approached the ISB compound, they heard a familiar voice call out. It was Buckyball League security officer Olivia Sharp, and she announced her presence by saying, "So, got yourself into a little trouble, have you?" And that is where we resume the story.
Can I just say first, I know you have to you have to catch people up, Ben, but if we could avoid the subject matter of brutally assaulting somebody in a nightclub from now on, that would be very much appreciated.
I mean, I feel it's plot relevant.
I get that.
It, for it's example, explains important. Why Soraya and Stefan aren't with the party at the moment.
And in fact, it explains Sharp's opening comment somewhat.
It does. Yes, it does. It does do that.
Okay. Fair point. Continue as you were.
The group turn around, and all with varying degrees of caution, happiness, relaxation, and tension, spot Olivia Sharp standing there, looking quite casual with a hand on her hip and grinning at you.
Sharpie! How are you doing?
I'm well, thank you. I came down here to soak up some of the atmosphere, get to see the teams and the craft up close, you know. And because security people tend to know other security people, and I got asked for a little favour.
Ah, you're not acting like some kind of a mercenary for hire, are you? Hunting people down?
Not a mercenary, no, but, you know, a local law enforcement person has offered me some really excellent seats to see the race in exchange for a little bit of help finding a couple of people who seem to have just dropped off the radar.
That person wouldn't happen to be their surname wouldn't be Locke, would it?
Yes, I assumed you'd met.
Yes, we have. She woke me up. She woke me up, Sharpie. She woke me up at like 7 o'clock in the morning. It's just not on.
It's almost as if there's a crisis of some kind.
She did say she'd hired someone that we knew. She seemed very pleased with herself. And I can see why. She's hired the best of the best.
Well, that's very sweet of you to say so. Now, I mean, I'm probably going out on a limb here, but there isn't any way you could just tell me where Stefan and Soraya are right now so I could go and get them, is there?
I'll be honest with you. I don't know about Agnar, but I honestly have no idea where they are right now.
I'm sure that's probably true.
It is.
Do you know where they're going?
No, I don't know. Like, I'd like to think that if they've heard the news and find out that about these lies that have been spread, that they might want to clear their names, but I wouldn't know.
I mean, I'm sure that's one way they might approach it, but this seems like a pretty small city. Like, if they were to just take a stroll down a busy street at any point, it wouldn't be very long before someone would point them out. So I'm guessing they're probably not looking for identification at the moment.
That might be the case then. Like I say, I don't know where they are and what they're up to. They might have been asleep the whole time since then. They might have fallen asleep in a water pipe somewhere and just woken up to shock and surprise. Might still be asleep. Sarah's nearly as bad at lying in as me.
It's certainly possible. You see, when I heard the news, I was a little bit surprised that one of your crew would just randomly stab someone. But then I thought about it and I thought, yeah, it's not exactly the way I see you guys, but yeah, I can see that happening. And then I heard that Soraya was under investigation as part of a plot to poison a Pelago team. And I don't know Soraya all that well, but I do know she's very serious about her sport.
She's very serious about her buckyball.
I can't imagine she'd poison a team or have anything to do with poisoning a team. So
no, it's not
I'm
the way.
Assuming there's a little bit more to this than meets the eye, right?
Yeah. Like, to be honest, as I told Locke, it's Fess is very much the key to it. I don't know if she's told you what I told her and what Agnar told her. It's definitely all floats around this guy, this Fess guy. He was the one that made a phone call when he was chatting with me. He was freaking me out, as he always does. He made a really snidey, put me on edge about, he just phoned a guy when we were up there just before it all happened. I don't know what it was. I've said he's got to make a call to someone, sort of said something. And we were worried for the rest of our team that, you know, that he was sending someone off to kill them or something, so I wouldn't put it past him. And he'd sort of said, oh, it's so nice to see you. I like you so much. That's why it's just such a shame that you've got to be here, kind of thing. As if he was the one about to do something deeply unpleasant.
Mm.
But you're someone that looks at things both ways, and you're right. I'm glad you haven't just dived in like the media does. You know, they are guilty, do it. You know, we've worked with you a couple of times now. You like to get to the bottom of things and do things properly, and I think we both feel relieved that that is the case. We feel more at ease with you around.
Well, I can certainly see that the Maglo poisoning might have been a misunderstanding or an accident. It might have been nothing to do with you guys at all, and I have no problem with accepting that. But I have seen a little bit of footage of Stefan literally shoving a knife straight through somebody's throat, and I feel pretty confident, therefore, that they probably got the right guy for that one.
I heard it happened in front of about 100 people.
Yeah.
The thing is, I think there's no fighting the fact that that happened. But from where I was and the conversation, that Soraya accidentally sort of misunderstanding, like she saw the chip from the Maglo team on the ground, and she saw Fess pick it up and thought he was stealing it, so she shouted him out, and the look of anger and evil, and I don't know if we've talked to you before about the grief we've had with him in the past, but the look of like white anger at her, and she ran and he immediately gave chase after her, looking for her with like murder in his eyes. So if I know Stefan, he's known Soraya for years, you know, he would have only done it if he really believed that something horrible was going to happen.
I've already had a little bit of a conversation with our esteemed investigator, asking her one question that I can't really share with you, but it was a critical question that might change the way people perceive the sequence of events. And maybe I've smoothed the way a little bit for you guys, but in exchange, we are going to have Stefan turn up and face actual questioning, possibly a trial.
What do you think the with all the smoothing, what do you think the outcome of his trial would be? If everything I said was true, for example, just then, and could be proven. Because it's still stabbing someone, isn't it?
It doesn't count as self-defense, if that's what you mean. I suspect he'd be found guilty of some form of lethal assault. An attempt to murder or an attempt to cause brutal damage. But his sentence would likely be mitigated quite significantly if it were demonstrated that he had cause.
It might be worth, I don't know if anyone's done this, but seeing as he was seen as the victim, has anyone gone through Fess's device?
You remember I said I'd asked a couple of questions to put a couple of ideas in front of Locke's approach to things. The device you're talking about, I'm afraid, doesn't appear to be openable. It requires a level of security that nobody here seems to be able to crack. Sorry. But I did ask if, for example, Fess were interrupted on his way from one place to another and did not expect to be unconscious, hospitalized, and so on, it's possible there might be something on his person that would put things into a different light. Obviously, I can't tell you whether or not anything was found and what it was and what different light that might be, because that would be a gross, gross breach of trust. But
of course.
Anyway, it turns out my question was well received. Now, you appear to be walking towards one of the compounds of the Pelago teams.
Yeah, we're having a wander. Oh, by the way, Agnar's here as well. I don't know if you've seen him. He's hiding behind his fancy helmet. He always says he never trusts his little helmets since we had that problem on the seamstress, of course.
Yes. I did spot the giant general. Hi, Agnar.
Hello. Sorry, this is very out of the blue. How are you? Are you all right?
I'm completely relaxed and calm. I'm trying to work out how I can ask you, since I don't have any real local authority, to turn around and walk back rather than visit any of the teams, because I think it would look potentially quite bad for you guys if you were spotted loitering around a third team that was as of yet not hobbled, broken, or murdered.
I can see where that would be an issue.
I'm speaking as a friend.
Yes, of course. As a friend, could you answer a question for me? Because I'm slightly worried. I think more worried than Kara is. She seems all right about it. But the evening of the event, we Kara and myself found ourselves in the hotel bar, and we were having a nightcap, and we were approached by a member of, is it the police force, Kara? I think it was the police. Somebody. It wasn't Locke, anyway. But they mentioned that there was cause for concern about sickness with Soraya and Stefan, and that there'd been something that happened at the nightclub. Is that, were they just trying to fish for information from us, or is that to do with the alleged poisoning, or is there actually an outbreak of something that we need to be worried about our friends?
I can tell you, I don't think you have anything to worry about. The poisoning is not alleged. There are some quite ill people. Having said that, I don't think you need to worry, since you're not currently a member of any team, and specifically not the Maglo team. And I think it would probably be best if none of your team do get sick, just in case the authorities think that means you mishandled some of the poison while you were trying to poison people with it.
That would be a really unfortunate series of events, wouldn't it?
So we're definitely not poisoners, are we, Agnar?
No.
I mean, you do have some medical training, though, General, am I right?
Yes, of course I do. Have you read the full report of the events that happened that evening?
I have. I was impressed, in fact. By many things. Many things impressed themselves upon me. Violence, the panic, the random smoke bomb that has occluded the camera for a little while, the sheer chaos as the Maglo team, already starting to feel a little bit unwell, were also trying to stampede their way out of the building. That was remarkable.
But he did save him, didn't he? Didn't you, Agnar? What a guy this is, Sharpie. He saved him with his own hands and skills.
The smoke that obscured the upper part of the lobby made it a little bit difficult to make out on the camera exactly what was happening. But I'm prepared to give you the benefit of the doubt and assume that Agnar wasn't, in fact, trying to make sure of the kill.
Let me stop you there. Is the man still alive?
He is, at the last I heard.
I know I have some down... There are some things that I'm not very good at, and he leans in and whispers, don't tell Kara about the swimming. But let me tell you, if a man had been that seriously injured and stabbed in the neck, and I wanted to finish him off, I think that is within my skill set, as I think is saving the same man.
Yes. Well,
which would have been the harder of the two, do you think, to accomplish?
Truthfully, I suspect it would be easier to kill a desperately wounded and heavily bleeding person than it would be to save their life. I'm not an expert, you understand.
No, of course. But, you know, I think that speaks volumes for what I really did that evening.
Yes. I don't doubt it, actually. I've seen statements from people who suggest that you were instrumental in helping to save the victim's life. However, I also know how tight you guys are as a group, and so I know that there's a reasonable amount of evidence that saving his life may have been just as much a part of the plan as stabbing him.
Agnar laughs a bit. I think you possibly give us too much credit, but thank you.
If it had been me, Sharpie, I'd have killed him.
You're that bad at first aid.
Yes, I'm not the only one of our team that's that bad at first aid, it must be said. I've never killed an injured man before, let's put it that way.
So, I mean, I'm vaguely hoping that you'll wander off and not visit these pavilions, but as I've already pointed out to you, I'm afraid I don't have any authority to actually stop you. Should I be calling for the police to come and escort you away, or are you just meandering about?
We are meandering. We're sort of getting a vibe of the scene. It's very rare to come to such a place. We can't go anywhere. I don't know if you've heard. It's not like we can leave for a bit. And it's very rare to be able to enjoy such an amazing event. Neither of us are none of us are big Pelago race fans until now, so it's wonderful to sort of catch the vibe of what it's all about, see the excitement, try the salted salmon sandwiches, and just really enjoy seeing the teams in their wonderful colours. You said the device was incredibly difficult to hack. You know that I have some experience of hacking on the seamstress as well as other places. Mm-hmm. Would it be worth my while or anyone's while, albeit being carefully observed, me having a go at it? Would that potentially be helpful in a we've got to help each other out in these situations kind of way?
I can propose the idea to Locke. I don't know exactly how keen she'll be on letting a close friend of an attempted murderer go through the personally secured electronic devices of the putative murder victim.
Totally understandable.
But I can suggest it if you've got the skills.
Ah, they've paid the bills in the past. Give it a go.
I've often suspected such. So, you're not, in fact, going to turn around and walk away, are you?
Just very quickly. It seems odd to me. I'm no expert, but it seems odd to me that a nautical expert. And what else? What was he doing before, Kara, when we met him on planet?
Oh, he was a he
something
was
to do with the Commodore.
Rocks. He was a rock. He's a man of rocks. He's a man of water. He's a man of fish. He's a man of racing. He's a man of creepy hitting on female crew members and threatening crew members. He's a man of planting bugs on us, which seems ill repute. Ill repute, I'd say, Agnar.
It seems weird that a man with so many avocation. I'm not sure what they are. It seems weird that a man of so many skills and two names would have such a high security device, doesn't it? Surely the police, the security services on Giikur. I mean, we saw your techies on the seamstress who were good, but I'd imagine that they'd be just as good here.
Ooh.
It just strikes me as weird. That's all. Wouldn't you say?
Well, in my experience, quite a lot of people have elevated security above what they might strictly need simply because they're private people.
But above that of the fine Giikur police force. I'm not a local, but I assume that when he looks around, you know, it's quite a nice place here. There's some well-to-do people. It seems as though they would have a well-trained force here.
Well, I don't wish to speak ill of anyone, but for the most part, I think they're pretty basic. Locke impresses me. She seems diligent, tenacious, one might say, possibly rabid, in her pursuit of not just people, but also ideas. She seems to have a lot of ambition. Could have used her in the service, but the rest of her people, pretty ordinary, I'd have said.
Okay, well, that's fair enough. That's my mistake. Interesting, though.
Sharpie, are they? is Fess booked in under Anton or Mattis? We know
in the hospital.
Yeah.
For reasons that I'm sure you can understand, he's actually booked in under an assumed name.
Of course, I understand. I just, you know, want to make sure that
everyone's... Common practice for victims of crime.
Understood. I just want to make sure they know, if they're aware of his many different... his different names and his different roles and maybe his background somewhat. Being in the special forces of Sodani. Folk, that sentence came out terribly, but you know, it's the air down here. It's just so thick. It's just very difficult to talk and think at the same time.
He was Zodani Special Forces, was he?
Apparently so. Yeah, so we've heard.
Interesting.
Well, was,
is,
who knows?
Yeah, I think he was. In fact, I believe he was a. Bear with me. I'm just trying to get it. So thick. It takes me time to think. I just need to get it right.
The kind of information, though, that do an ambitious investigator very well, I feel. If it turned out to be true, of course.
Yes. He was. They say. I've heard that he was like psionic police, so he can mess with your brain and stuff. So be careful around him, because when he's conscious, he can be messing people. We always felt he was giving us the juju. Mm. So I just want you. You're smart. We like you. I hope you still like us, at least us two. And you're just careful around him. Like you say, don't worry about this lot. You know, care about Locke and that as much as you want to. We just want you to be careful around him.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do drop in to visit him, whatever he's in under, be sure to let him know that he can thank me that he's not in under Jundo.
Really?
In a joking way, you know.
Yeah.
Don't bring my name up. Come to think of it.
It is an interesting thing that everywhere you people go, death seems to just follow.
And now I feel that's somewhat unfair. Whilst I, you know, appreciate that footage is available that may link some of our party to events that happened. Those events haven't actually resulted in a death. And the events to which you refer, which did result in death, were very clearly nothing to do with us.
The direct
actions that resulted in said deaths were nothing to do with us.
Well put, well put, Agnar. I would say that deaths followed the Taraknor house on in the Seamstress, and they followed the Diaspora on the way back on the Seamstress. I think it would be a fair way to
talk about people who were on the Seamstress and also here at this present moment in time. Sharp just gives a cheeky smile.
I'm not a believer in guilt by association.
We helped solve these things both times, which, in fact.
Which we are very thankful for.
Yes. Well, as I say, I have nothing to arrest you guys for. It would make me feel more comfortable if you were not to visit any of these teams, but perhaps more importantly than that, I'm going to walk away now so that I'm not here when you decide to do whatever it is you do next. And if you could see in any way the possibility of managing to make it away from this team area without killing anyone, that would be, I would treat that as a personal favor.
I mean, I can 100% guarantee you that we're not going to kill anyone here today.
Then I will count that as a win. When you eventually decide that it's important that Stefan make himself available to the authorities, feel free to call me and let me know where he is. I'm not suggesting there wouldn't be a financial motive in it for me, but I would also take him into custody myself and then deliver him to the authorities in a way that would mean he wouldn't accidentally get shot by people who were very frightened of him.
Yes. That would be appreciated.
Absolutely. This seat you've got to watch the race, there's not extra space for a floofy Varga, is there at all?
There are two seats. In fact, I don't have anyone to currently watch the race with me. So, yes, that would be fine with me.
Wonderful. Well, there we go. Everything's coming up roses.
Thank you. That's very kind.
I'll bring an Ixixa board during the slower parts of the race. We can play each other.
That sounds like a wonderful day after the morning. When is it? I'm really not a fan. But thank you.
The first of the preliminary races is tomorrow. There are 3 days of those. And then straight into the full race.
So prelim races tomorrow. How many days of prelims did you say?
3 days of preliminary.
3 days.
3 days. I'm sure we talked about it before. We did talk about it before, so I'm not going to ask her about it, if that's okay, unless you want me to do it. I can go through my notes because I'll have it written down, Ben, I promise. You know what my notes are like. The prelim races are all local, aren't they?
Yeah, they're basically laps of the island.
Yeah, as opposed to going across to where we want to go.
Mm-hmm. The first 2 days, the first two races are compulsory for the teams. I mean, they're not literally compulsory, but they set your ability to pick where on the start line you want to begin the race. And teams often feel that they want that in their own control. Even though it's a long race, they still feel there might be a slight edge to being able to pick where you want to start from. As a consequence, those qualifying positions are set over the first 2 days. The third day is completely optional. Lots of teams use it as a shakeout for any changes they've made or strategies they want to try or team combinations they want to try, but you don't have to.
Okay. Cool. Thanks, man. Fantastic. Well, especially if you've got seats for the prelims, that'd be fantastic.
Seats for the whole thing.
There you go. Perfect. How about that, Agnar? I guess I'll be dining alone tomorrow. Well, you're exixering away for the afternoon.
if it worries you that much, we can play a few games and when I get back.
No, you're all right.
In the evening.
I'm sure you'll be exixed out by then.
Not me. Never.
You should show it. You should show the picture you took of your board that I got you. She might appreciate it. She's a fan.
Cost seems, me seems a bit showy.
Go on, no, do it.
Maybe later.
Kara, can you roll a quick persuade check for me with intellect, please?
Yes, I can. This is in my wheelhouse. We'll see. 7 + 4 = 11.
Okay. As she sort of walks off towards the main part of the cove, where those restaurants and support buildings are up against the cliff, Sharp stops and turns around and looks at Kara and then at Agnar, and then sort of smiles at Agnar and says, I'm pretty sure you didn't do one of these crimes. I think I'm convinced there may be some merit to the other one. If you want my help, if you can arrange for me to be able to chat in person or remotely with Stefan, maybe I could give some help to him when dealing with the authorities. Assuming he gets in contact with you, of course.
That's very kind of you. I'm sure he'd find that very helpful and something that could be sorted as part of this whole deal thing we've already got going on, it seems. Absolutely. Thank you. That's very kind. I hope he does get in touch. We haven't heard from him for a while. And I miss his little face, his beady eyes and his hairy chest.
You've got my contact number. Let him know I'm waiting for his call, and I will be as open-minded as I can be.
No, that's very kind of you. Thank you very much. If we hear from him, we will tell him about that and tell him to get in touch with you.
Okay. He turns and walks off.
Kara, I think she was she was serious about not mingling with the Thames.
Yeah, I know, but she also turned her back, man.
Like, yeah, but that's not always a a message to go for it, you know.
Every time she's turned her back in the past, I've used that as a chance to do something.
But that doesn't always necessarily mean that that's what she intended.
Have fun doing it. I get my way. She doesn't have to answer any questions. Life is good.
I mean, I pitched it as that's why we shouldn't do it, but I also think she has a valid point that if any of them were to suddenly... I mean, I don't think they will be, because... Well, I mean, there might be.
There was no pictures of Athens in the news.
I would assume they wouldn't come down with some weird poisoning thing, because, well, from where I stand, Vess is in the hospital. But it's not necessarily him who has committed the poisoning either, to be fair. We may be jumping to conclusions. And I worry that if we are seen to be, meandering around teams, and one of them falls ill, not going to be those two that are in trouble. It's going to be all of us.
It is true. As it stands, though, our faces haven't been on anything. And I know that we would then be linked by those in power, but not by the general person around here. I guess when they played footage back, they'd see me, not you, because I just see some big guy in a big helmet that you can't see properly into. But I see your point. It just feels like this is the way to get done what we need to get done. You know? Are there other ways? I don't know. We need to get onto the island. Framus isn't around. She's off shindigging around all over the place. I asked you, John, I messaged to ask you whether you wanted Kara or Agnar to utilise it. Because we will, I promise. But, you know, if you're nervous about it, then, like, I got you, you know, I get it. If you can think of another way to get our stuff done.
No, I mean, to be honest, the only other in I think we've got, other than trying to make one, gestures out towards the teams, is don't we know someone at the Imperial Naval Base here? We went there, didn't we? We were worried about the somebody that they had held, and we got them released.
Let me check.
The names escape me, but I'm sure we've at least made contact. Maybe a relationship is stretching it.
I think it was just general. General soldiers that took us to Paramus. We got to the base, they shot us up in a ship to Paramus.
Mm.
If I remember correctly.
Okay.
Anyway, look. I think your head's scrambled. Maybe you need a bit of just refreshing. And Kara's going to lean up and slap his helmet really hard on both sides to jiggle his head around with a big clonk.
Stop it!
Boof, 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 boof. Jump, boof. If you're scared, you're scared. You know, I'll admit it. You know.
Scared, I'm worried. I'm just a bit worried, you know. Things have changed since we first came down here.
They have. Things have changed. I noticed your fur getting whiter over the last 24 hours. Must be the stress. It's the stress. bit patchy in parts.
It's the stress of raising you three kids.
But if you want to hold off a bit, we can hold off a bit.
No. I think we need to limit it. We need to limit it to one team that we talk to. I don't want to go around talking to everyone because that just increases the chances that one of the teams going to get poisoned and we're going to end up in trouble. Whereas if we talk to one team, get in, get out. Mm-hmm. Keep your hands in plain sight. Don't hold up any funny devices that might, you know, spray. Agnar would actually probably know better than I do. How people would be poisoned, but you know, spray mist or vapor into people's faces. Don't pass them any food. Don't touch any water bottles. You know, and as long as we're, I don't know if there are cameras around, but as long as we're seen to be talking to them from a safe distance, then perhaps we should be all right.
He's going for COVID protocols. I would suggest, Agnar, that a big, strong Varga like you probably shouldn't be fully armoured up with helmet and all. I think it would be a sign of good intent to just wear the standard mask rather than having your full helmet. Hearts and minds, Agnar, hearts and minds. You should know that as a military man.
Okay, sure.
Fantastic.
Have you got a spare mask?
I'm sure there are. Oh no. There'll be one somewhere, surely. I don't know. Did you not grab one as we left the ship? Heck no.
Why would I do? Look at me. Why would I do
that? Okay, look. I'll run back and get it. You go find ISB. Was it ISB we were thinking about? They'll go closer than ever, they think. ISB are going to get closest, okay. They think. You happy with them?
Yeah.
You go then with the other two. I'll go run back and get the mask. I'll go run back and get a mask before. Okay. You hunt them down. All right.
Yeah.
Kara rushes off back to the back to the little shuttle to grab a spare mask. That's
okay. Okay. Yeah, it'll be probably 10 minutes round trip.
Yep.
Okay. So while you're doing that, a couple of things. First of all, Kara, can you roll a streetwise, please, for me with intellect?
Yes, I can. Do, 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 do. Oh, second seven of the night. Nine. Oh, sorry.
Okay.
Spilling all over the place. Nine.
All right. The crowds are building up steadily over time, and particularly because you've got to go past the Maglo team, which there's a big crowd out there who are very excited by the news and very, very interested in Maglo's prospects. You do have to push through a few sort of dense pockets of people, but nothing seems to strike you as being unusual. You don't spot anyone following you or paying attention, and you don't catch a glimpse of Sharp at all as you make your way on the round trip. So turning to Agnar, what are you doing, Sal?
How condensed are the teams? Is it easy to spot ISB from here?
Yes, from where you are on the apron, you're pretty much in front of the ISB pavilion. It's built across a pair of quays with a sort of a dock in between those two quays where they keep their craft. But because it covers both of those quays as well, there's a fair amount of land space inside their enclosed pavilion, and it stretches a little bit inland to provide some space there as well. They also have little miniature buildings, cabins, tents and things outside for everything from team meet and greets to signatures to merch sales, you know, the stuff of a working sports team.
Rough distance?
If you're down on this part of the apron as you were heading towards ISB, you're probably about 20 meters from the point where you'd have to go through their perimeter, and probably another 10 meters beyond that before you'd actually be entering their main building.
Okay. In which case, Agnar will, in fact, he'll take a step away from their enclosure and wait for Kara.
Okay.
Basically, there's no point in her running to get a mask for him to make him fit in more socially if he just goes straight up with what he's wearing whilst he's waiting for her to run and get a mask.
Fair enough. The others who are with you are, you know, staying close. Kat seems to be chatting amiably with pretty much everyone who walks past. She's in her social element here. Freya is much more reserved, and Sammy is staying very close to Kat and trying to smile at everyone that Kat talks to.
Freya. I hope you don't mind me saying, you seem somewhat quiet.
There are so many people.
There are a lot of people. Listen, would you feel more comfortable if you were hiding? I mean, it's not a camera, but if you were hiding behind a device recording some footage for me, you could look at the screen and it would be just like you were watching it. But in fact, if you're watching it out from the camera,
I don't know if I'd feel more comfortable, but I'm certainly happy to do so.
Are you any good with the camera?
Good question. Hold on.
Aha. Sure. Aha. Visual media. Niche skills.
Not especially.
Oh dear.
Well, listen. I don't want anything fancy. I just.
Good.
I have some concerns, and I'd quite like you to just make sure that all of us, apart from yourself, obviously, are in the shot at any one time. And there is a full-length video of us and what we are about to do, should we need it.
Okay. All right, I can probably do that.
Thanks. I mean, try. We're probably not going to need it anyway. I'm sure everything will be fine. Thanks.
Okay. Yeah.
Hands over his device.
All right. She immediately fires it up and gestures to the other two to close up a little bit towards you because they weren't really close enough to easily fit in frame. But Cat will happily blend in anywhere, and Sammy will stay with Cat, so it's no problem.
Oh, perfect.
And she's in the process of doing this when Kara makes her way back towards you guys.
Oh, Freya! Oh, you filming?
Yes.
Hey, Kara Lasker here. I'm here at the Pelago race with my friends and my buddies. Got a new camera woman today. Say hello, Freya.
Hello.
She's the best, but she's learning everything I know. She's smart. She's intelligent. She'll make someone a really, really good wife one of these days. Do you want to be a wife to someone, Freya? Are you happy as you are?
I suppose I'd quite like to be married.
You see, everyone. So if you're interested, drop me a line. We'll vet you. We'll vet you, though. There'll be a lot of swiping. I forget which one's the ignoring people. Swiping left on a lot of people. But you never know. We love to meet new friends. Give us a call. She knows it's just a random call. It's not a vlog at all. But she's just trying to make Freya laugh a bit, I guess. Anyway, Agnar, got your mask. She just chucks it at him.
Thanks. Switch over his masks. I just figured that Freya filming an interaction we have with the team might be beneficial should anything happen to them.
A good idea. Kara looks at the screen and sees it's all like blurring out of focus and pointing at the wrong thing, no doubt. And tries to subconsciously sort of just carefully move into the right place and tap to sort of automatically focus it. You're doing a wonderful job, Freya. You're doing really good. Have you ever done this before?
Not really. I've filmed some dig sites, but not. They don't move as much.
Well, just keep poking at this big floofy buffoon, okay? And whatever's going on, and you can't get too far wrong.
Okay.
I am becoming rock.
She seems to indicate that it's all going well, but you have no way of knowing what quality of footage she's getting.
Wonderful. Well, after you, Kara.
Freya's terrible at this, Agnar. I don't know what you're trying to get out of it.
What? Stage whisper, Luke.
Freya's terrible at this, Agnar. You do know that, right?
Yeah. She did mention it. Listen, I only picked her because she seemed a little bit reserved, nervous, shy. I thought it would be a nice, you know, she could hide behind the camera. I hear that's a thing. I know it's not a camera, but it's got a camera in it.
Oh, modern technology, huh?
I thought I could kill two birds with one stone, you know?
Don't mention killing around these teams. It's supposed to be on hearts and minds, not murderous intentions. Only say nice things. No killing. Okay. No poisoning. I know what you're like.
You just said it.
Oh, come on. Anyway, I don't think anyone. I think I got away with that one. Anyway, lead on.
It's fine anyway because we are the good guys.
That's right. We are the good guys. She goes
Nobody to give, is gonna get hurt.
She goes to give him a high five. Yeah, we are the good guys. Anyway, you lead on. You're the general. But remember, these sort of posh people respond well to "Don't you know who I am?" I think it's your strongest weapon you can have in this kind of conversation.
I'll keep that in mind. Thanks.
Flawless plan.
Yeah, now proudly walks off.
Okay, so is Agnar leading the way?
It would appear so, unless anyone else is willing to jump in front.
No, I'm fist bumping the homies. There we go. Lovely.
You approach the partition between the public areas and the... It's not what you call high security, but there's a little barrier around the outdoor section of the ISB compound. It's only about 10 meters or so from that fence back to the entrance of the building. And they do have a couple of people in ISB jackets standing there answering questions and chatting with anyone who walks up to the barrier. The barrier does have just a gap in it, but there are a couple of people standing there and they sort of look fairly sternly at anyone who approaches who they don't recognize. And so they cast an eye at you as you come up towards this gap. Can I help you?
Oh, yes, this is a perfect shot. Wonderful, wonderful stuff. Yes, I think you possibly can. I'm the director of Carl Alaska's vlogging productions. He gestures behind him to Kara and Freya walking up with the device shooting. We wondered if we might have a few minutes to talk to ISB about their shortest possible route we hear.
Can you please roll a persuade with intellect for me?
Yes, not social.
Don't you know, what? Under the circumstances, social would probably work, yeah.
I also feel that a deception might might be worth arguing, but...
Well, you can have deception with intellect or persuade with social.
Ooh. Okay, I will... I'm not going to figure it out. We'll go persuade with social.
Oh, you're right. Well, anyway.
That is an 11, but it's minus 1 overall.
For so a 10. Okay. They sort of look at each other for a moment, glance across at Kara, and there's sort of a, I'll take you in.
Thank you, we're a small team.
One of the two subscribers walks off. It's not entirely clear whether he's being honest that he recognizes Kara, but he probably doesn't want to say, if you know what I mean.
Okay. I like to think he does.
It's quite possible. So he he sort of waves the group in and walks through with you to the front door to the sort of hangar building. As he approaches, it opens automatically. The building is basically identical to the other hangars used by the other teams. And as you walk in through quite large doors at the front, what you're standing looking at is a large dock full of water, obviously, just open to the sea, with a very substantial surround, a deep sort of 10 meters worth before you get to the water. And then on both sides, more like a 50 meter long walkway down both sides. And those are wide walkways as well. Mounted in the dock are several watercraft, a variety of different types. And at the far end of the dock, there are gates that are closed over the entrance to stop people coming in and out from the sea without being let in. Right in the middle of the dock, carefully moored in a sort of webbing of cables and buffers and what have you, you can see the purple and black painted high-speed craft that the ISB team is entering into the competition. And it is a sleek, streamlined looking beast. It looks as if there isn't a single gram wasted for anything that isn't intended to make you go faster on this. It is an absolute thoroughbred of a watercraft. And that sort of open area, as you go through where those doors opened, they sort of opened into a short tunnel area, which essentially took you through a thickness of the front wall of this building. And in that thickness are some offices. So as soon as you're through the part of that tunnel, the chap turns to the left and walks you along a little way and then knocks on a door to the left again. So effectively mounted against the front wall of this hangar. And a couple of seconds later, the door is pulled open and there is a middle-aged woman, younger middle-aged, I would say, you know, we're talking early 40s, perhaps.
It's definitely younger standing middle-aged, in the doorway.
and she says, hi there. Can I help you?
Oh, hello. Yes. Yes. I'm Agnar Arnson from KLVP, Carl Alaska Vlogging Productions. We're here to ask, if you don't mind, if you've got some time, to ask a few questions and give some publicity to your fine team. The ship looks amazing this year. Have you cut down on the weight?
I've been cutting out some of my bacon intake. The ship is beautiful, isn't she? Yes. The Cara Lasker, I'm sorry, that went by a little fast.
Cara Lasker Vlogging Productions.
Oh, KLVP. Right. Can you roll a persuade for me with social or a deception with intellect?
Yeah, sure. I'll stick with the persuade.
Okay.
It's a 9 minus 1 is an 8.
All right. She looks, you know, faintly doubtful, I suppose, but not by any means hostile. And she says, well, I'm Cassie Trotter. Call me Cassie. I'm the skipper of this craft and de facto team captain for ISB. Welcome. Would you like to see the boat?
Oh, Cassie, it's a pleasure. First, let me... Cara, come up here and wave up, Cara. Freya, make sure you get this in the... And get the security guard in as well. Get this whole shot. You know, if we need to crop it down later, we'll do that in post. It's fine. Keep us all in. It'll be good for some B-roll. Cara, come and meet Cassie.
Cassie Trotter. Nice to meet you. My name's Cara Lasker. She holds out a fist to bump.
No, don't bump fists. Sorry, her hands are insured.
Mate,
the policies are covered.
Look,
Cassie will happily hold out a fist.
Look. Agnar.
Go on.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry about him. He's very officious. I'm starting to wish I hadn't hired him. He's an absolute nightmare. All I want to thank you for having us. I can see by the look in your eyes you're not necessarily a big fan and know who I am or anything, and I totally get that. We're still we're sort of new kids on the block, as it were. We just want to sort of bewitch people in a way with the way we do things. We're very take that in the way sort of we produce things. It's quite
I don't like that.
It's they always say this sort of thing's a real sort of boy's own, and we want to make it more woman led. And for sort of the younger generation, get them into sort of these sort of events, the excitement of it all, and just sort of do things in a sort of a slightly different way to some of the turgid ways. And we were looking around, and sort of we've been doing our research and sort of looking at a lot of footage. And you guys really struck us as the team to watch in this regard, the one that could really get a lot of excitement amongst the younger audience. Last year, you were the ones that really, you went for the short route, you know. I don't know if you were the skip last. Do we know that? Hang on. Were you, because last year, I won't bring that up, sorry. What do you think? Because last year, it was, you know, VCI. Because of course I know it wasn't finished last year, but it was the shortest attempt, like almost as short as it could get, and that's kind of cool, you know. And I think the younger audience don't want the ones that play safe, And that's why we come your way. Good colour, good looking ship. Female skip as well. It's just perfect story. Just right for the youth, I think.
Yeah. I was having a conversation with the Xander skipper this morning, and he suggested that, you know, if we were going to keep running these very short race routes, we should probably go for more brightly coloured livery because it's easier to fish us out of the water.
There's glory in even in glorious, I'm not going to say failure, but, you know, just trying on the edge. And sometimes it's worth being fished out, falling a little bit short, you know, but being the team that everyone has an eye out for. I don't know. I like the livery you've got. It looks sleek. It looks stylish. It looks cool, to be honest. The colours are on trend. I don't know if you follow colour trends on the fashion and that.
Not really, but I like the way the boat looks. Yeah, I really do. But then I like the way it looked last year, and it did not end well.
I know, but are you feeling confident for this year? Do you mind if we talk and walk around this ship as we... You offered to show us. Are you okay to talk and walk because we look at this beautiful beast?
Absolutely. Always happy to show off the boat. And she sets off, pointing out some of the salient features as you go.
Oh, man. Make sure you get footage in, Freya. Make sure you get it. How's it looking? You okay? You getting all the angles nicely? This is good footage.
I think so.
We'll put some good music to this. We'll get... Seabat Engage, they're hip, they're good. Have you heard of Seabat Engage? They play around Giikur.
I mean, I'm sure you're right. Seabats are a bit of a sore point here.
We've run into Seabats ourselves in the past. I totally get it.
Yeah, but you probably weren't doing 1,000 kilometres an hour when you did.
Well,
that's true.
I'm pretty certain Agnar hit that distance at that speed as he was running away from them.
Yeah.
Oh man, now this is looking really good. Are you looking to go tight again this year? Sort of, as I guess, as a question, like this, would you say that you are a team that takes chances, that pushes things the best? You can tell with this beautiful machine; it looks like it's cut to within an inch of its life. It looks more ripped than Agnar's six pack under that. Under that suit, he's gone.
Truthfully, I think we're always going to be struggling to compete with some of the wealthier teams.
Oh, but that's cool, though. That's
how we stay in the game. Is we try to be a bit different in our tactics.
That is rock and roll, right? That's like not necessarily going with the big bucks. That's the plucky. Like, really edgy approach. That is perfect for the audience. You see, Agnar, this is what I said, right? This is spot on.
It's a good fit for how we like to produce our videos as well. Mm. Yeah, I feel like it's a nice pair, nice pairing. We'll get a fisheye on this in post, and we'll CGI stop motion some of you, so some of you are moving at different times to the others, and we'll put some nice Seabat music over the top. It'll be perfect. Edgy.
Yeah.
An edgy interview.
So,
well, the big three, the rich three teams, they all, well, they're going to go big this year, though. One of them's Maglo, of course, and we don't know what that's going to look like this year now.
Oh, man, they're rammed out there. I had to fight my way past. I've got a lot of people paying attention to them.
I think there'll be a lot of curious tourists, but also a fair few thinking this might be their chance to hitch a ride, you know?
Who would you say are your main rivals for this year, then, do you think? Who do you think are the ones to beat?
Well, Detton's always going to be a threat. They've got a lot of money, and this year they've done something a bit controversial, shall we say?
not more controversial than having red on their colours. Red's so out of fashion.
Buying in a third party craft is a bit it's a bit iffy, you know.
Yeah, no, for sure.
But I think they're going to be a threat. Maglo's going to be a threat if they can get their team put back together in time for the race. And other than that, it's always going to be Corton, who've got lots of money, and Xander, who've got lots of young, fast, experienced, frankly, adrenaline junkies on board.
It does sound like it's the challenge. Have you heard, like, Xander sound like a team that might try it on, or are they, you know, they're fast, are they a bit careful with their routes?
Last year, they did really well playing a, I wouldn't say conservative, but a not particularly risky route. But it wasn't enough to win. They didn't have quite the horsepower of Maglo, and they didn't quite catch them, but it was close.
I guess every year.
We don't know what they're going to do this year, but if I were guessing, I think they'd probably run a bit tighter.
But going tight is your thing, isn't it? Which, and that's the cool thing about it. Especially like you've got some of these islands that you've really got to slow down for. Like, you could just take the wide berth and sort of give it wide, but in the past, those are the ones that you've really cut through, right? Gone pretty close to land at times. That danger's cool.
Yeah, I mean, truthfully, if I wasn't skippering this team, I'd be skippering theirs. I like the Xander people.
They're all right. I like
Impact as well, but I don't know if they've kept their guts from last year. I like the short route runs. I'm less interested in the big money teams.
Ah, that's the right attitude. We're the same on our channel. We're the same. Speaking of, like, gutting teams and changing teams and that, how many have you got on your team this year?
At the moment, we've got a squad of, I think it's 11 people signed up. We're trying various combinations, two races tomorrow, two races the day after. At the end of that, we'll have a pretty good idea of who's going to make the cut, and we'll also know whether we're first or last to pick a start point.
I take it the team that wins gets the first start point with the fastest speed. I guess that's quite a good thing to have, first pick.
The reality is, you start in a known location, and they're quite a big distance apart. The race is from your start point to your start point. Everyone does one full circumnavigation. It doesn't matter where you start from in theory. But in practice, people want a different line into the first turn or the first cut they're going for, or they're a bit worried about the weather or shoaling coming in for the finish or whatever. Everyone has their favourite start positions.
There's a lot to it. What size team will you run, do you think, on the race on this craft at year 11?
We'll probably average about sixth. That's pretty typical. We may start with as many as nine. Probably not quite that many. We're a lightweight craft. Fair amount of power, but we'll be slowed down in the acceleration phase. Don't really want to be trailing going into the first couple of islands. So probably seven or eight to start. We'll probably aim to finish with no more than three.
Wow. Three. So you really are, like, that last stretch really is your bare bones.
Yeah. yeah, for the last bit, it's incredibly busy at that point. There's a lot for three people to do. And if we don't feel we can do it with three, we'll hold on to a fourth, you understand. But we don't want to if we can avoid it.
Right. I know this is ridiculous, right? And I totally get it. But is there, have teams ever been able to take on like I don't want to say passengers, but you know, like a crew recording, someone doing a documentary or a piece or something like that. Is there space for that kind of thing? Has that happened before? Press team, yeah. Thank you, Agnar.
I mean, I'm not aware of a team doing it. There's usually aerial cover, of course, so people can see close-ups from above the race. But having someone on board, I mean, how many people are we talking? You want a camera?
Yeah, so like you see the four of us here, right? We're just thinking it'd be the thing, right? It'd be such a different thing, and we get some really cool stuff. We're looking at we've got I'd like to think, camera. You were talking about maybe needing a fourth. You could always say this here, the security. Her name's Kat, and she's a proper good navigator pilot. That's her previous job, part of security. I don't know if you wanted to run her, like she could be run through the process that you run through to see if she could be like the final fourth person, like put her up against the rest of your crew, of course, but she's good. This guy, Agnar, the guy, I don't think I could get away from him, but three and then maybe someone that's actually good at stuff.
Okay. So you'd be presenting to camera, and the idea is that's all you'd be doing on the boat.
Me personally, there's other stuff I can do as well if it's useful. So I'm I guess my big things are I'm really good with comms, I'm really good with computers and computer systems, I'm really good with philosophy, if anyone's feeling a bit miserable and wondering the matter of life. She sort of smiles as she says that. And just like visual media, it'd be as, you could choose how it was, whether it was like very much me just talking or almost like a reality type thing. You know, like almost like a scripted from me, or just like just being there, getting the vibe of it, really making a good thing with all of us being all hands on deck. You know, helping out us. It could be us showing how it, you know, not looking at the front, of course, where things might be a bit private, secret, but, you know, how things work as much as you'd let us do it, you know, getting our hands dirty, trying it out. Just really showing the youth, you know, the team and what they could aspire
to. You can do comms.
Mm.
If I may, Cara.
Yes, Agnar, you may speak.
You can look at this two ways. You could look at it as you're gonna take on a team and make use of their, I'm gonna be honest, probably somewhat limited skills, but very good skills where they do come into play for this year and see what happens. Or you could look at it as you're gonna let this year slide a little bit and deal with the, gain some publicity and some exposure, and then potentially have some more of that. We're obviously not talking Maglo money, but you know, some more cash to play with for next year. Both are options. There are, you know, as Cara has alluded to, there are skills amongst the team that would be of use, I'm sure.
We're in constant communication with HQ and observers above the race. We're getting constant updates of changes in wind and weather and shoal and tide. We even get updates on movements of large concentrations of wildlife. A comms person could be very useful. And during down times when you're off shift, you could definitely help out with some publicity work, as you say. We don't have a dedicated comms person. You'd have to prove your worth.
Mm-hmm.
Prove you could pull your weight as part of the crew.
Okay. Sounds good. Could I do that as part of a piece, or would I need to do that privately?
You can be slid into the races tomorrow.
Nice.
We'll give you a tryout, basically.
Thank you. Could I, not necessarily on the ship, but could I record that I'm doing this, or would you rather that was not recorded until, you know, I get onto the crew and we do the thing, like make it a whole big piece, you know, here I am for a couple of days with the team, trying out.
We have sponsors and they want coverage. So I'll tell you a few things you can't film.
Mm-hmm.
But other than that, have at it.
Fantastic.
Now your pilot, and she looks across at Kat. So we've got pilots, of course, but it's a competitive game. If you want in, you can have a go and see if you stack up against the ones we're trialing. And Kat sort of grins and steps forward and says, yes, I'll join your crew. You're very welcome. No, you have to try out first, you know, to find out if you're as good as the pilots we've got. And Kat says, it's fine. I'm the best you've got.
Oh, I like a confidence.
And she then sort of turns and looks at Freya. So you do camera? And Freya peers out from behind slightly nervously and says, sure, why not?
Don't be so modest, Freya. Sorry.
You got any other skills that might be useful? And she thinks for a moment and then she says quite a bit nervously, like she's quite timid about it. She says, well, I speak like 30 languages, if that's any help. And immediately this smile breaks out and says, you mean we might have an actual full-time comms person and somebody who can answer press questions from the boat in multiple languages? Yeah, I think we'll put you in for a trial. If you can pull your weight, you're there. She turns and looks at Sammy. And what do you do? And Sammy says, I'm a geologist, but I also do meteorology and oceanography and big form atmosphere and some astrogation and navigation stuff. Okay. If you can do those skills and you can pull your weight, that's good. And she turns back to Kara and she says, so here are the rules. You can talk to any person about anything. You can film anything you like, except look at the boat right now. See how she's sitting sort of in the water. You can't film anything on the boat that shows anything that's currently underwater. At speed, lots of stuff that's currently underwater will be above the surface, but you can't film that. That's secret.
Cool. So anything under the water level. Got it.
Anything under the water level when the boat is still.
Got you.
It'll be out in the air when we're moving, but don't like point the camera over the side and show what's underneath or even sticking out the sides. We have custom devices and designs that give us what we hope will be an edge.
Thanks. I'm sure it will be. Judging by previous sort of speeds and things like that. No, that's amazing. Thank you.
All right. I don't know which races each of you will be on tomorrow, but I'll try and get all four of you onto one of the races tomorrow. Briefing for race one is at 0500. See you then.
Wait, 0500?
Yeah.
As in the morning?
Yes.
Okay, that's good. Just making sure.
Okay.
I thought I misheard you for a second. That's okay, good. Okay, yes, see you tomorrow. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thanks, man. We'll be back. Let's do this. Let's bring a lot of excitement and a lot of good times.
Excellent. Okay. And as you wander off, we'll take our break.
Fantastic. Thank you. Right.
Glorious stuff.
Glorious.
Right, let's go for 5 minutes then, everyone. Please feel free to go to the loo, grab a drink, whatever you need to do. We should be back in 5 minutes with a toast and the second half.
See you in five.
Let's turn that off. Music on. Let's put the brake on, whatever that is. I think it's there. And let's turn us off, which is that one. And Hey, Brace Bracer, I'm back. It's me, Luke. I'm here after 300 seconds to bring you joy over new galabalists thing. While we wait. I wasn't dedicated to you necessarily, but no. I think we should make any more 300-second promises. I just got a bit confusing. Here we go. This song's dedicated to Sporing. I'm drunk anything tonight. Sporing Space Freighter. I don't know if it's going to fit the music, but I thought it'd be a nice intro before everyone comes back. Here we go, hang on. Yeah. Taxman taking on my dough, won't let me in my stately home. Sing along! Blazing on a sunny afternoon. And I can't sell my Pelago. The tax man's taking all I got. Blazing on the sunny afternoon. There you go, that's pretty cool. That's very good, that's pretty good. Anyway, everyone's back. Over. Oh, I can try out the new bar actually. Over. Oh, it works. Over to Ben. Our new screen works, Ben.
You sound surprised.
I love it. It did take a while, though,
well, thank you. So this is the point in the evening where we raise a glass. So charge them if you've got them. Tonight's toast is more of a prequel. You see, next week we'll be welcoming some wonderful people to Faversham to begin the RP gaming weekend. And we will naturally welcome people the only way we know how,
by meeting them in a pub and having some form of drink. It's going to be a really fun way to kick off the weekend, and by way of an apology, it means we're not going to be able to do our normal streaming activities next weekend, so sorry about that. It is a moment we expect to be truly joyous, but tinged with a hint of sadness, because we'll be missing a key component of the team whose skills would be absolutely perfect for a social gathering like that. We will be unable to sit comfortably while a perfectly trained ship steward brings us drink. There are a couple of reasons for that, of course, but the most important one is the thing we commemorate with these toasts. Our shipmate, Greyhill Bast, was lost in the line of duty, shot by a villain on a distant world, and then healed by people so inept that they simply hastened his demise. Next week, however, for the first time since we started streaming, we'll be together with drinks in our hands on a Friday at a traveller-like moment. So that will be an opportunity to toast the great man in person. Until then, I give you the prequel. Please raise your glasses to the late, great Greyhill Bast.
To Greyhill Bast.
Good wine tonight.
Oh, I'm glad you have.
Can I have a proper suggestion, Ben? Can we do a toast next week and just I think stream we that should. And nothing else?
And I think we can probably even, I don't know we'll if do we can do mobile. It live, but we can probably upload it or something, can't we?
Yeah.
But we should definitely do a toast.
We've got a few people drinking with us that evening, so we can toast.
That's right. I feel that would be the way to go.
Yeah, it's the least we can do.
As we are...
Net for net.
So, yes, we'll do an actual toast with people live next time. I don't know whether or not we will put it online, but we will do one in Greyhill's honour anyway. So, it probably falls at this point to... do a sort of soft dissolve to what's happening a few miles away from where we just left off in a utilitarian hotel
that's the soft dissolve, isn't it?
on a nearby peak, Pito, where Stefan and Soraya are in their very basic hotel room.
What time of day is it then? Give or take?
At the point where we left off the events in Olympic Cove, which is where the boats are for the race, that was about 11:30 a.m. So you can jump in at any point in the morning you want and run with Stefan and Soraya for whatever they want to do.
Do you say it's called Limpet Cove, as in a limpet?
As in a limpet, yes.
And a cove as in a cove.
It's Olympics.
As in a cove, yes.
Limpet Cove, it makes sense.
Yes, it's just a little bit north of Lake Simmel on that map.
Yeah, that's where I'd put Limpet Cove if I was naming a city. Okay. I don't know, Stefan. Do you feel the need to be up at a certain time? Did you have any plans, Ewan? If we're given the freedom of the clock.
No, probably not. I like to imagine that, you know, in their supplies, they would have had a bottle of something that
they Stefan did in
would
fact
have indulged in.
Yeah,
they did.
They did indeed stock up very well with alcohol.
We have cheesy balls, protein bars, chocolate, sweets, cereal bars, 3 days of bottled water, plenty of vodka, long life juices, two cheap communicators, a lighter, cigarette papers, and many clothes, some Giikur playing cards, binoculars, a penknife, some lovely t-shirts and hoodies and things. Lots of magical stuff.
It's like the conveyor belt.
Cuddly toy.
Everything
you get a cuddly toy.
Well, in that case, Stefan's definitely going to have a very slow morning getting to Rice. I would imagine the two of them probably stayed up reasonably late and had a few drinks and wallowed in the basicness of their hotel room.
I like to think that
I may be wrong.
I like to think that Stefan wakes up with his heavy head, with feeling a slight impact on his forehead, as Soraya sat at the other end of the bed, slowly throwing playing cards towards him in a very bored manner. She's also got quite a bad head, and she's trying to entertain herself and keep her own morale up.
Oh, like
flicking the card. Flicking the card.
The card off his chest.
Flicking the card.
Looks at the ace of spades. I was at his side. It's a bad omen.
She's still got a cigarette paper stuck to her head from a game they'd played the night before while drunk.
How long have you been up?
Oh, man. About half hour. You seen the news? You haven't seen the news, have you?
I caught it while I was asleep.
Yeah, I thought you did. That would explain the screams that you were giving out. So,
what's on the news?
You're not a murderer. Congratulations. Flicked another card at him. The monkey. Hey, monkeys, how you doing? You had a good session tonight.
Hey, monkey tails.
A chunky session from the monkeys. Any deaths tonight?
Chunky monkey.
Chunky monkeys. Any deaths tonight?
That's compromised.
I think it might be, sadly. It's going well, even better now. Thank you. You've just turned up in a seedy hotel with our two people that are running away from the law. So magical times. Yeah, we all popped in for bits, I think. They all got a bit of us. But I hope you had a wonderful time. I enjoyed the bit I watched. And
as did I.
I always enjoyed the hooded Croy. He looks incredibly... the hooded Croy is very sinister. I really like it. He goes a bit extra Scottish, which I like, just for emphasis, I feel. It's good fun. She flicks another card as she's talking. You're not guilty of murder. Turns out he survived. And they said he was taken to a medical centre. They're not saying what or anything like that. I'm not surprised, really. They're probably worried that you're going to go back and finish the job. You're not going to go and finish the job, are you, Stefan?
That was the last thought in my head. I was in fact just thinking maybe it's better to turn myself in if he's alive. I'm not sure I want to be out in the universe with him holding a grudge, you know.
I think it's a bit too late for that.
Behind bars.
You know he can get to you that way. He's psionic, isn't he? He can get to your very innermost being just by walking past the outside of any prison you're locked up in for the rest of your living days.
No. There's like, most of them have this, you know, like buffer area for just such psionic abilities, I'm sure. Some of them, not most of them.
Well, judging by the more tabloid media, I think you're more likely to be locked up in the dingiest, dankest, most horrible place full of horrible people. At least that's what they want from you.
Just send me back to the Baltic Star.
You laugh, man, but I'm a bit upset because I'm wanted.
What are you wanted for? You didn't do anything.
I know, right? But they said that basically they think the two of us have like tried to poison Team Maglo and tried to poison all these other people, I don't know, and stabbed him up because, I don't know, Bance or something, and trying to destroy all the teams and... hey, Rosinka. Destroy all the teams and I don't know what, man. It's all a big conspiracy and we're the two villains and they've posted two photos everywhere and like, but one is of me with like some cheesy balls in my mouth and so it don't look good. One of you is looking, I don't know, a bit bruised and a bit hungover or something. Pretty much like you look now, actually. Flicks another card towards his forehead. So I wouldn't go out right now because you look exactly like your photo. Whereas right now, I feel like I'm looking... exquisite.
Are you saying we need disguises? If we're gonna go, we've got to go out at some point. Are you saying we need disguises?
Well, we got to go out, if I remember, in about the next 30 minutes. Otherwise, I don't know what's going to happen. We're going to be zapped by the all-powerful juice dispenser. I don't know what. But, yeah, we got to go out.
But what did you pick up? What can we make disguises?
She reaches into the bag, the clothes bag. She pulls out some stuff. She chucks you first a geek's hoodie. Well, I got you. You got a choice. You got this very swanky geek's hoodie, very classy. Or, and she holds up one with like a really cheesily done. It was a cheesy hoodie, wasn't it? Like a geek, a fish with a cheerful, a buff looking man in like a lumberjack shirt, pulling up this big fish sort of thing, and I don't know, a really badly painted on like sun and like the peaks. It's like I love heart Selville. I got you this as well. It's pretty cool, right? In its own way.
I'll take the silver one.
Yeah, man, you'll rock it.
It's got a hood, right?
Yeah, but I got one size tight, so it's a bit buff on you. Is that okay? I think it's the best.
I don't have much choice, do I?
It's the best size for you. It's the best size for you, this one, I think. You shouldn't hide yourself underneath the baggy clothes. I got you these. We got some plain baseball caps. Keep it down over your face. There you go. She sort of flicks it across instead of a card. Tries to get it onto the top of his head. Baggy-wise, I did get us some baggy trousers. They're very fashionable right now. To get these on, they're full of pockets, man. I wouldn't have known it, but honestly, pockets are everywhere right now, it seems. There's like pockets within pockets. It's like pockets to put pockets in, almost. Look, have these on. I think I've got your size. I'm hopefully they're not... They looked a bit weird. They might be ankle swingers, but I think they might be all right. So give them a go. Yours are the purple ones.
Obviously.
Of course.
Did you get any sunglasses or anything? You know, hide there. Hide more of the face.
No, but I did get you a Giikur Export Consortium t-shirt. I know you probably like them. Probably. Well, I like them.
Yeah, but I'm wearing a hoodie.
Wear it over the hoodie. Take it in turns.
And that is not inconspicuous, is it, really?
You can't just wear a hoodie.
Can you imagine the hundreds of people in the street pointing, oh, look at that idiot wearing a t-shirt over the top of his hoodie.
Cara told me it's the fashion right now. Mm-hmm. But look, you can't just wear a hoodie without a t-shirt underneath or anything. It was just like, I don't know, you'll get all sweaty. And then what do you do? You always need an extra level in case you get too hot. Do you know what I mean? You can't just strip a hoodie and just shut off your hairy chest everywhere. People notice you immediately. That chest's famous, man.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, give me the t-shirt.
Oh, that's good. I ain't got much. I think that's about it, though. Like the other stuff I got isn't going to help with fancy dress. Unless I make sort of a moustache out of these cigarette papers. We could roll them up and we could twirl them and stick them to your face. Put them over your eyebrows, make it look like you've got big white eyebrows.
That can work.
You've got to put on a bad Delavrue accent.
Paint the glass out of those binoculars. You know, take the front section off and make some glasses.
Oh, just have one and have a monocle.
Also, probably not inconspicuous, but I like it. It's outside the box thinking.
Thanks, man. Yeah.
That's what are we going to do? How long have we got to be out of the room for?
15 minutes. It's only 15. We've just got to lie low. We get out of that back exit. I don't know. Keep that door propped open a little bit so we can get back in again. Maybe see where it goes. And lie low.
What do you think happens if we don't leave?
If it's fully automated, I don't know, maybe it's a big jet stream of molten death, maybe.
Oh, like chemicals.
That's what I was wondering.
Oh, we could just wait outside. Shut the door.
Stand in the hallway with all our stuff. Thing is, if there's other people, they might be doing the same. And I'm sure people would be very interested to see us. Now, what we need is, I reckon we get out a few minutes before, beat the run.
Beat the rush.
But yeah, get out the back, have a quick look around for anywhere we can sort of a good stashing point for our stuff for later on, you know, just and just keep our heads down. The two of us together might not be a brilliant thing, but you know, so we've got to be prepared, I think, to go our separate ways and meet back somewhere again.
Yeah, I've got... in my experience, you separate, you've got twice as much chance of being seen, right? But if you stay together and you are seen, then people know it's you. Then they're more likely to realise that it's us, I would say.
Yeah, I think so. Like, maybe you want to, you know, I don't know, maybe we do need to... I have no idea what the right thing to do right now is. I just know that I don't want to make that decision in the next 20 minutes.
Tell you what, let's separate. Let's do... I don't know. We've got to do something, haven't we? Have you got anything you want to do? Are we doing anything? We're just lying low till...
We got enough to leave. We got enough food for 3 days, right? We booked in for free, and we got enough food for free. I just don't know. There's something we got to do. Like, what can we do? Can we even clear
out?
Cap jump. Yeah, just to keep yourself entertained.
Yeah.
I don't know.
A bit of time.
I don't know anyone. Honestly, man, I don't know anyone except you that I can talk to about it. I think we've got to stay off the comms to the others where possible. That's why I got these. And she chucks the cheap communicator she got to Stefan. And she's already messaged it with like her number on her one.
That's a good call.
So we'll communicate with these for now. Yeah. We'll turn our routers off and we'll just communicate with these as needed. And I don't know, man, we've just got to keep an eye out. Just if anyone catches a sight of us, people ain't going to confront us, right? Most people ain't. So you might not even know. The next thing we know is like a load of Poe around, you know, banging on doors, trying things out.
We don't want to be seen, right? But we certainly don't want to be seen coming back here.
Right.
So on your way back, make sure you're not followed.
Good stuff. I like your thinking.
Because there's no point in separating, right? If we both meet back here and one of us is followed.
Exactly. I think I did go into the shops yesterday and I don't know if they'd have clocked on that it was me. So people might know we're in the area anyway. So I don't know.
It might have been early enough.
I hope so. And hopefully they're so bored of people coming to the shops.
Find out.
Yeah, exactly. Okay.
All right. Well, so what time are you leaving? And are you taking anything with you other than some clothing and personal supplies?
If I remember correctly...
Sorry, Ben.
Sorry, yes, you.
I was just going to say quickly above game. Stefan picked up a tech level 13 anonymous communicator on our last planet. Does he need to turn that off in his knowledge or experience of such things?
You mean turn it off so it couldn't be tracked?
Yeah, or, you know, messages or...
If... It is essentially a secure device. It's not untrackable or unhackable, but nobody knows it's yours. So they're not looking for it.
Yeah, perfect. He won't turn his off then, if not. But he won't let Soraya know. But like, oh, yeah, thanks. I tend to do something and put that in one pocket and the other one in the other pocket.
So I was going to look up at the sign, because the sign says, if I remember, you've got to take everything.
Yep.
Yeah, we've got to take it, man. We'll bag it up. Look, I don't know. Is there bins or anything, Ben, for our junk?
There isn't a bin in the room, but you saw some in the corridor outside.
So look, let's take the stuff. Let's split it between the two of us best we can. But let's look for a place to stash it out back somewhere inconspicuous if we can. Let's get rid of the rubbish. Slim down best. We're wearing the clothes anyway, so we're a bit... There's less stuff with us than we did need. You know, let's get this going. Let's get out of here. What is it? 25, 22? Let's get out of here in 5 minutes, yeah? Before everyone else comes out at the last second. That gives us like half an hour, 30, and then maybe come back 5 minutes after. Gives us like 30 minutes to survive out there. How does that sound, Stefan? Does that sound all right?
I'll let you know when we're back.
All right. You head out into the corridor, carrying all of your important stuff. At 11:45. Can one of you please roll a d6 for me?
If not me, I hate rolling 1d6. No, don't make me roll 1d6. I hate rolling 1d6. Don't force it upon me.
Are you serious? How wrong?
Yes, I'm deadly serious.
deadly serious.
A six.
Deadly serious.
Don't say deadly.
Deadly. Sorry.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, no. Why did you roll a six?
All right. Come out of the room, glancing left and right. The corridor appears completely empty. Back towards the front where the lifts are, you can see quite clearly marked signs for rubbish chutes, for dumping garbage down there. And they're fairly substantial hatches, you know, they're not little tiny holes. So you can push big lumps of rubbish down there if you need to. So if you're going there first, it won't take you more than a couple of seconds to drop your litter and your leftovers down there.
Let's get rid of all that. Let's get rid of all the stuff we had. Just keep clearing space. Just keep making space. We don't want to revel in our own filth. I'm sure the police will one day go through all that rubbish, but let them get up to their elbows and skank.
So you're quite close to the front exit with the lifts. The other end of the corridor is where the rear exit, which is just a door as far as you can see.
I reckon we go it that way then.
Yeah, sure. Or we can split now. You're cool.
Let's have a peek through the door, see what's out there first before we make that decision. Mm-hmm. This might be an obvious route for both of us to go out from, you know what I mean?
All right.
Yeah, sure.
You make your way to the other end of the corridor. There is a glass panel in the door. And the door is one of those heavy-duty ones with a automatic closer on it, clearly designed as a fire door. Through the glass panel, you can just see a fairly bare-looking staircase, stairs up and down.
Is the door attached to any alarms?
No, not that you can see. Mm. And there's no sign indicating that it is.
What do you think, Stefan?
I mean, it looks quite...
Let's do it. Let's get out of here. Let's get out of here. If we take too much time thinking, other people might exit.
Cool.
Okay. You push through the door, and you're now standing in the stairwell.
Is it external to the building?
No, it's internal.
Internal. I don't suppose we can see up through the stairs.
No, they're pretty solid stairs. You can look up a flight, but then you just see a little mini balcony and it turns a corner.
Yeah, cool. Down? I was just wondering, Sarah, if it led to the roof and we could hide out on the roof for a half hour, but maybe that's something to check out. When everyone else is in their rooms.
Of an evening, perhaps.
Yeah, maybe for tomorrow.
I like your thinking.
Maybe.
Yes, I like your thinking. Do it. Let's go. Down. Let's go. Quick.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Okay. So you're heading downstairs. Only one floor down, you get to floor one in this building, which is effectively the ground floor. And the stairs come to an end. There's no further down at this end for the main staircase. where you would expect the stairs to continue, there is a door, which is clearly marked with basement, but it has a keyhole on it. It may be locked if you try it. You don't know. There is a door identical to the one you just came through that opens up onto the ground floor corridor. And directly opposite it, a completely blacked out door, no windows or anything, that leads to the outside. This door, however, has a big emergency push bar across it and signs indicating it is alarmed.
One, two, or three. What do you reckon, sir?
Middle. I don't know. Try the basement, man. I hadn't thought about that.
Stefan walks up and twists the doorknob, checks the door.
Okay. The door appears to be locked.
Curses. Locked. Thwarted at the first opportunity. Did you bring the key?
Have you got a hair bobbin?
Who are you calling bobbin? I've got lots of hair. Realistically, realistically she would do, because they were out the night before and she does have long hair that she'd have had up. I very much doubt his skills, let's put it that way. She will remove one of the two she's got. He's like, well, I've got two. I believe in you, Stefan. I do believe in you, but I would like to have at least one for, you know, that uncontrollable bit I get on this side sometimes. I'd like to keep at least one to keep that in control. Yeah, so have this one.
You keep that one. I'll have this one. It doesn't matter because, you know, this is useless against that. And he gestures towards the door. You need at least two tools, and one of them is not this. And he tries to comb his hair over the other way and make it like some kind of parting that is not Stefan looking in his hairstyle. But thanks for the haircut.
You're clever than me. You look like a totally different man.
Thanks.
What Sarai does is she makes sure her hair is as best as possible under the cap with the hood up, and before they go out, she repositions some of the spare clothing underneath the t-shirt to make it look like she's a portlier character than she actually is.
Okay.
How about you, Steph?
Are you
relying on the hair and hair alone, Stefan? You look very different. You look like a whole different man.
He's put the cap back on over the hair and put the hood up.
Yeah.
Okay. He's just keeping his head down. But if you do, you know, if you do come across any, any hardware stores or shady individuals that are selling any lockpicks, then maybe think about picking some up.
Okay.
Well, see if we can get this door open at some point after we've checked out the roof tonight. Keeps his voice down.
Midnight drinks. Lovely. Go on, let's get out of here.
Maybe. Right, let's go.
All right.
After you. I'll wait a few minutes.
Yeah, I'm sure you will.
All right. So Sarai is pushing open the door to the main corridor.
Yes, please.
All right. Can you roll 1d6 for me, please?
4.
Okay. You don't sprint or anything, but you're moving fairly briskly down the corridor. That sort of prickly feeling between the shoulder blades, worrying that a door could open behind you at any moment and someone could pay attention.
Yeah.
But you actually make it all the way to the end of the corridor without a door opening.
Yeah.
And there, of course, you can approach the door that leads straight to the lobby. And right there, the door just peels open, because it automatically opens if someone approaches from the inside. And within a second or two, you've crossed the lobby. The front doors are open. You can step out onto the street.
She doesn't want to look too suspicious in her peering around, but as she's walking across it, is there anything very obvious directly outside?
Can you roll a streetwise with intellect for me, please?
I care. One's changed sheets. Streetwise with intellect. They have two good numbers for me. They're not that useful for her, though, because she's rolling badly. It's a 4+2. Obviously, her mind's on other things. It's a 6 in total.
A total of 6. Possibly, as you say, a little bit distracted or worrying a little bit too much about how long Stefan will be and whether he'll catch up with her if she lingers too long, you know, that kind of thing. Perhaps too unfocused to really pay attention.
Okay. Well, no doubt thinking that she has is kind of paying attention, she immediately slips out the door. And now I've walked out there the night before.
Yep.
In that direction that I went, do I know of any sort of quieter bit, you know, darker roads or alleys that I would have remembered, like within a few steps, I guess?
There are several places that in the night looked pretty dark and narrow, yes. This is one of the more congested parts of the town and not one of the wealthier. So there are lots of fairly crowded together buildings for accommodation, for office units, for shopping units. And there are quite often little gaps and alleyways. These things have everything from rubbish facilities to accesses to backyards and gardens behind flats and things like that.
Cool. So she's going to do that. So purely remembering the adrenaline's going, like say the heckles are going. She's not looked out the front too much because she likes to have her mind on other things. But in her mind, she's thinking, get out that door, hang that left or whatever. And that corridor that looked dark on that first walkthrough, I'm just going to, as casually as possible, just make it to there.
All right.
And just take a moment.
You end up stalking down a little narrow alley that leads to an open area behind a couple of office buildings. These are multi-purpose office buildings where individual units are rented to different businesses. In this case, most of the businesses are white collar, financial, insurance, legal services, that kind of stuff. And you wander down that until you find behind there's a bit of an open yard. From this direction, you wouldn't be able to drive a vehicle down it. But the yard has entrances from multiple sides, and there is quite a large entrance almost opposite you. Down there are bins for rubbish collection. There are a few marked spaces for vehicles to park in, though none are actually parked there at the moment. And you can see the backs of various office buildings. A couple of them have external fire escape type systems. And there is a single sort of desultory looking light post, which is obviously off at the moment, it's daytime, which is stuck in the middle of this and looks rather out of place given how largely gloomy and unlit the place was last night.
What she's going to do is she's going to look to see if there is a spot, maybe some long forgotten rusted corrugated iron, or like, you know, just something, not that just something that looks like people haven't messed with it for a while, that stuff could be shoved behind or in, or, you know, like our supplies.
Can you roll a streetwise with intellect for me?
I can. Streetwise with intellect. Oh, that's more like it. That's my third 7 of the night, though. 7+2 is 9.
Okay. over towards the far corner of this yard area. It's not immediately obvious at first glance, but you realise that one of the larger recycling unit rubbish bins is actually mobile. It's been shoved into a corner, but it's on wheels. And it's, it looks like there's a gap behind it that you could indeed hide some stuff temporarily.
Mm. Cool. What she's going to do is, because if I remember, when we got the stuff, it was two big bags for, wasn't it?
That it was.
Ridiculous. And then she's got the stuff that she was wearing as well, which said, she's, if she's not careful, she's quite layered up. She's got her invisibility clothes, which of course she's keeping on as a second skin right now. I said that anyone in chat, she's not like, doesn't make her super invisible, but it's, it can help potentially. So she's got that. She's got, she'll have the jumpsuit on. She won't put the baggy trousers on. She'll have the jumpsuit and the hoodie on. That makes sense.
Yes.
So she's, and the cap, and of course the cap. So the hoodie up, cap, and then the jumpsuit and the thing underneath. With a weapon, of course, but you're allowed to carry in gigs. That's okay. So she's got a bag with some food supplies and some bags with like the baggy trousers, one of the t-shirts, you know, one of the hoodies, because there was two hoodies each in that. Mm-hmm. So that clothes bag, she's going to, I guess she's going to test the waters, and she's going to shove the clothing behind there, but keep the bag that has some food supplies and the, some water for now.
Okay.
She's all nervous right about leaving both things, if that makes sense, but she wants to check if it's a safe space. Carrying one bag looks less suspicious than carrying two. By its very nature, I guess so.
All right. Can you roll a stealth check with Dex for me, please?
I can try. And I do believe with her it is an I can try. Okay, so 0 plus 0. So let's give it a roll. 5. Oh dear. Tried.
Okay. You shove it behind the bin. It makes a bit of noise while you're doing it, sort of big booming noise from the back of the metal bin, but it's not horribly loud. You don't think anyone would have heard it.
Okay. Then what she's going to do. How busy was the street as I came out?
It had people on it, but not crowded.
Okay. While it's quiet here, she's going to give herself a few minutes just to catch breath and recover her mind and, you know, just catch vibe of the area.
Okay. All right. While you're taking that pause, we will turn our attention to Mr. Miller.
Hello.
But you're still in the stairwell at the back of the
exactly
hotel.
Stefan's probably going to give it just over 5 minutes. He'll start looking through the bag that he's got packed, and he'll be like, oh, I should have known she'd take all the cheesy balls. What I'm left with is these protein bars. It's too early for one of those. We'll hang around there for a bit. Does if he waits there for say 5 or 6 minutes, does he hear any doors go or see any people?
Can you roll? Actually,
I mean, if he hears a door go, then he'll react before he sees a person. But he'll be trying to judge how busy the stairwell is, basically.
Okay. I am going to suggest that a streetwise check, but you can use you can use either education or intellect with it.
Okay. I know it's a very brief period of time to get. He's not trying to get the whole, you know, busyness of the staircase, but it is, in theory, it'll be the potentially the busiest time of day, to his knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
That's a 2+2 for streetwise. A 4+2 for streetwise is 6.
6. As far as you can tell, you can't hear anyone at all using the stairwell. You don't hear anyone using the lift either, but that may simply be because it's too far away.
Sure. And as he's hanging around, is there an underneath the stairwell? The stairwell sort of finishes, right?
Yeah.
Is there a space underneath, sort of like round the back of the stairs, potentially?
There might be in a strictly architectural sense, but access to it would be blocked by the door to the basement. That would be kind of underneath, but it would that doorway would stop you getting there.
Sure. Okay. No worries. That is all he is interested in there. Once the 6 minutes has passed, he will go through the enter the corridor and head out towards the entrance or exit in this case. Okay. We'll pull the cap down.
Can you roll 1d6 for me, please?
It's another 6.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah, that's good or bad, but I prefer those on the 2d6 rolls.
So you make it all the way to the end. The door opens as you approach the lobby part. And then you can step out onto the street.
Wonderful. He'll walk out onto the street and not break stride. He'll just continue going straight out. He is less familiar with the area. He only knows his way in from the from where they were dropped off.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't peruse around last night.
Yes.
But I don't suppose he happened on our way here. Did we see any construction or roadworks or anything similar?
No, nothing of any note. There must, in a city this size, be such things going on, but you wouldn't have passed anything of any real note.
Mm. Okay, he will head in the opposite direction from which they came in then, with a view to potentially find something like that.
Okay. So, first things first, can you roll a stealth for me with dex, please?
Mm. Yes. 10+3 is 13.
Okay. As you move through the street, you feel pretty confident that you look completely blended in with the environment. Nobody is giving you a second glance at all. It just feels like you are completely in charge of the situation.
Classic.
As you meander through the streets, you get towards the sort of southwestern edge of Pito, and there you do start to see a little bit of construction, which seems to be temporary constructions right on the edge of the peak. There are big signs up, you know, warning people there's construction ahead.
Oh, yes. As he strolls through the streets, he thinks to himself, it must be the hair clip. I'm blending right in underneath the hat and the hoodie.
Absolutely.
And he just wants to keep a little eye on he'll keep an eye on the construction for now. Ideally, what he wants, Ben, is a high-vis and a helmet.
Yeah.
A hard hat and some high-vis. because you know you can go anywhere if you're
on. Oh, high fizz will get him anywhere. Yeah.
Plus, it's the epitome of hiding in plain sight. So he wants to try and keep an eye out for either some opportunity of somebody dropping or somebody being a little bit careless with their equipment, or potentially an office, not necessarily an office, but you know, like a locker storage space or something like that.
I get it. The logic is the exact opposite of walking down a high street in like military camouflage.
Yeah.
You know, people will spot you from miles away wearing military camouflage in a high street, but a high vis jacket and a bright blue helmet, nobody will pay any attention to you whatsoever.
Yeah, precisely.
This is very sneaky stuff. I like it. Okay, as you make your way down, you start to realize that this construction area is effectively temporarily taking over an open sort of a public square, more or less, right on the edge of the peak, which normally has benches and market stalls and things like that overlooking the sea and the downhill of the island. It's part of the civic open spaces. What you see when you get there, however, is that a fairly substantial crew is working assembling temporary seating overlooking that peak to make for some not fantastically expensive but valuable seats to watch the boats go by for the Pelago race. They've also assembled a gantry in front of them which will have some screens to show the race in a bit more detail for those who are set up there, so they'll be able to occasionally see a boat go past, but more importantly watch on big screens collectively. There are a fair few people wandering around, and there are indeed some high visibility clothing, not specifically jackets, but a kind of jumpsuit arrangement, which is high vis over the entire body. They're loosely fitting, but very clearly high visibility workwear, and indeed head protection. In this case, bright yellow.
Wonderful. He'll sling his bag over his shoulder like it's full of some work gear and stroll confidently up to the least well attended, I suppose, set of high vis. Let me know when to stop and attempt to just start putting it on in the street there.
There are a number of places where little cabins have been set up on the edge and mounted on pegs, literally right by the entrance ways into the building site. There are jackets or outfits and helmets there, along with sort of work boots with protective toes and that kind of thing. Yes, can you roll a stealth for me, please, with Dex?
It's a 5, but he does get a plus 4.
Yes.
A total of 9.
9 total.
It's his wheelhouse.
This is his wheelhouse.
As you're sort of in the process of pulling this kit on, somebody wanders past and throws a glance across at you and says, are you just coming on shift?
He'll quickly put the helmet and, you know, start fastening something on the back and trying to cover a bit of his face with his hand as he holds it. Yes, yeah. Just starting.
All right. Are you my end or are you with the other team? Oh, sorry, I'm down at the south end.
No, I'm the other end. Do you need a hand down at the south end? I'm sure they're well ahead down there. I'm sure we'll be okay.
Unless you're authorized to sign off on the certificate, I don't think I can use you.
Sorry. not one of those types.
All right. Okay. Have a good day. And he wanders off, waving cheerfully to a couple of guys who notice him and pay you no attention, as it turns out.
Just because I've got Stefan's shoe size written down on my shitty little pair of boots as well. A 9.5, preferably.
Oh, yeah. Is that a Giikur 9.5 or an Austin 9.5?
It's a universal shoe size, Luke. Let's not get into this UK, US, and it, EU.
An Imperium 9.5. Okay.
It's hard enough in real life. I don't want to roleplay it.
I think in EU measurements, 9.5 fits a hamster, doesn't it?
Pretty much.
Yeah. He'll sling a 9.5 over his shoulders and he'll enter sight and walk the opposite direction of that guy.
Okay. As you might imagine, it's a big open area, and what they're doing is assembling gantries and scaffolding, basically. Running cabling and power wires for data and things of that nature. They're installing speakers and sound systems and everything you'd expect for this kind of public event. As such, because it's spread out over a quite large area, there's a lot of people, but they're not crowded together. They're just meandering about doing their own thing and working pretty independently. There is stuff lying around that you can, if you're after something in particular, but if you just want to sort of walk out the other end through another gate and disappear, then that would be fine too.
He will be aiming just to either walk out a gate at the other end or, you know, hop under or over a barrier or whatever's along the side, separating it from the main street. But if he passes a tool bag that makes him look more the part, he'll definitely grab that.
Okay.
Assuming it's not, you know, somebody's. It's just lying around.
Roll a streetwise for me, please, with intellect.
Is an 8 plus 2. It's a 10.
Okay. There are several different types of toolkits that are just lying there as open boxes. There are some quite substantial heavy duty tools used for assembling scaffolding and main, you know, crane access points and attaching equipment and lifting big things off the ground. There are considerably smaller tools associated with wiring in electricals, literally like an electronics toolkit for connecting up wires and speakers and screens and you know, data links. And there are also what you might call a general everyday domestic toolkit kind of tool set. A fairly typical set of screwdrivers and things of that nature. If you were guessing, you'd think the reason they've got so many of these out is to attach things like seats to, you know, gantries.
He'll pick up a generic workaday toolkit.
All right.
And stroll through to find the nearest opportune exit from site.
Okay, there is one. If you keep going in that direction, there is one at the end of the worksite. I will need you to roll, I think.
One too many.
Probably. Because it's actually crime that people might pay attention to, whereas work boots, they're generic. A deception with dex, please.
Oh, no.
Rut roll.
Okie dokie. It's not bad. It's not plastic. That's a double fives for a 10 plus 2.
That's not bad.
Yeah, that'll do, I suppose.
Zero for deception.
Yeah, we'll let him off.
Yeah.
It's an uncomfortable when you're a wanted man.
Yeah. It wasn't in practice going to be all that difficult because you'd laid the groundwork by pulling on the right kind of clothing and everything. You look the part as you pick up kit and walk off with it. Nobody actually challenges you. Nobody shouts. Nobody seems to notice or care as you make your way out onto the street in your high visibility outer clothing with a medium-sized tool bag slung over your shoulder.
Wonderful. He'll keep his head down and roughly how long's it been, Ben?
The route round and then getting dressed and everything, you've probably been out of the hotel for at least 20 minutes. And then remember, you waited the best part of 10 before following Soraya.
Perfect. He'll head back to the hotel.
Okay. You walk back towards the hotel, straight back, more or less the route you took down, slightly in parallel probably to begin with, since you came out a different entrance from the worksite. It's only, 5 minutes walk, 10 minutes walk back to the hotel. Are you going in through the main entrance again?
Yeah, he will do. He'll take the hard hat off and keep the hood and the hat on underneath. It should be said that the hood was underneath his hard hat, because
that's construction the way worker round.
Style.
Yep. Yeah. Obviously, that's the right way round. Yes. Okay, so you walk down the street. Can you roll a streetwise for me, please, with intellect as you go?
That's the one. That's a 4 plus 2 is a 6.
Okay.
Here we go.
You make your way down the street and walk into the hotel lobby. You don't notice anything out of the ordinary. When you arrive at the inner door, you have an electronic ticket, if you remember, for your room, which you can wave at the sensor to let you into the main corridor. You make it literally in through that second door. And as the door closes and you sort of glance around just to see if anything stands out to you, there is a person out on the street who's looking at you, perhaps a little curious as to why someone in full work gear is walking into a hotel that doesn't have any work signs in progress. More like they're just a local, perhaps, who's interested that there is work going on in the hotel. It doesn't look suspicious, but you do notice it.
Okay. Stefan will pay it no mind outwardly, but he'll head to the lift and he'll aim to get in the lift.
Okay. Can you roll 1d6 for me, please?
Yeah. That's a 3.
Okay. The lift door opens at your floor. You walk out down the corridor. Nobody seems to be in the corridor. You make it all the way along to your door, which is quite far down. It's most of the way towards the other end. And as you...
Sorry, Ben, could I jump in quickly? He'd want to take it to a different floor, assuming that there are floor indicators on the outside of the lift. He'd go a couple of floors up if he could, and then go down the stairwell.
Okay. Absolutely. Yes. You walk along the fourth floor, shall we say?
Yeah.
And indeed, you see nobody there, all the way to the stairwell. And then do you want to go down to the second floor and then cut back?
Yeah.
All right. When you get to the second floor, can you roll 1d6 for me, please?
Yes.
That's two. It's a two. Okay. You open the door into the second floor. This is a short bit before you get to your room, of course, because your room's quite close to that back entrance. Again, there doesn't appear to be anyone in the corridor. You get to the door, and a swift wave of your electronic device, the door unlocks, and you can step inside.
Wonderful. He will do so.
As soon as he does, the lights automatically come on, of course, because there's a person in there. The door closes, and you look around to see that the whole room is immaculate, as if it had just been surgically scrubbed.
Very nice.
Okay. And with you there, we should turn our attention back to Saraya.
So she has a moment, and she realizes that this is where she's going to need to run an experiment as to the safetiness of her hiding place. She's a bit paranoid, I guess. And so she